Hey everyone, it's me, RX Codes. In this tutorial, I'll show you how to make a simple typewriter effect just like this. It's perfect for dialogue, subtitles, and heck, use it where you see fit. Undertale is one of the most popular examples. It plays around with this feature a lot, and it characterizes every aspect of it. A very slow typewriter speed can indicate that the character is feeling down, or is tired, or just talking very slow to show emphasis. Or a very fast typewriter speed can indicate that the character is excited, or just rushing, or talking very fast because they're full of energy. The sound that you hear can also play a role in characterization. In Undertale, we familiarize a sound to a character. Can you guess who this character is? I'm assuming that you play Undertale, which I know some of you don't. And yep, that's right, it's Sans! I'm assuming you got that anyway, I don't know. Heck, a font can give personality to a dialogue. Well, okay, before we get ahead of ourselves, let's start our tutorial. So, how do you make that typewriter effect that you see in dialogues in Undertale? First things first, you need a text box. You can create a text box by pressing this flask near the bottom right corner and selecting label. This will create a new text box where you can insert text into it. And that's literally all you need. Whatever else you want to do, go ahead. You could put a graphic behind it, make it look like a dialogue box. You could put a different font on it, adjust it, change its color. Ooh, I got a good idea. Try to go on a date with it. Okay, let's ignore that. Now, the hardest part of this is figuring out when and how you want to trigger this typewriter effect. Because we're gonna have multiple dialogues and not just one. There's gonna be multiple instances of this. So we're going to have to make this typewriter effect execute multiple times and not just once. And the best behavior to use for this purpose is a receive message behavior. This will receive information sent from the broadcast message behaviors, which will be used in this typewriter effect. I'm using this behavior because we can trigger this behavior in any other object using the broadcast message behavior. We can pass in data, which we can use in our dialogue. Now, if you don't know what the heck I was talking about, you'll see in this video. You can set the event to whatever you want. For my example, I'll set it to start typewriter. Just make sure you're using the same event when using the broadcast message behaviors. You can think of them as a radio communication system. The broadcast message behavior can send information, like text, and all receive behaviors with the same event will receive this information. You can think of it as a transmitter in our radio communication system analogy thing, whatever. The event is like the channel that the radio is tuned to. If the broadcast and receive message behaviors are on the same channel, or they're using the same event, then they will be able to communicate. In our case, the broadcast message behaviors can send in what text to use in our typewriter animation. So whatever we put in here, it's gonna be used as a dialogue. And now you know why we need to use the broadcast and receive message behaviors. Yas! For now, I'll just leave this broadcast message behavior right here. So it just executes right when we start the project. Of course, you can have this behavior execute at any time you want. I'm just leaving it here just for convenience when we want to test it. And for clarification, it will use the same event as the receive message behavior. And I can put in whatever text I want to be displayed. Yeah. Back to the receive message behavior. For the typewriter effect, we just need to check a number. You can use a box container or a value behavior to store variables, but let's use a box container because it's easier for this case. This will track what letter we are currently on during the typewriter effect. Since the animation will reveal one letter at a time, I will rename this behavior for convenience. I called it current character. Let's also use a behavior bundle behavior. This behavior executes behaviors from left to right.
Jeez, how many times did I say behavior?
So before we do anything, we want to set current character to 0. So every time we start the typewriter effect, it will always start with the first letter. Oh, why 0? Why not 1? Because computers are freaking weird, okay? They just like to start with the number 0 when counting stuff. That's why the first item in an array has an index of 0, not 1. Wait, some of you don't know what an array is. But you get the point? Click on your box container and click on this icon on the left of this input field. This allows you to change variables on the fly. It will be set to 0. No need to start this behavior. And like I said earlier, you want this to happen first before anything else. So plug it in the very left of the behavior bundle. Remember, behavior bundle forcefully executes behaviors from left to right. Now, we also need to know how long the text is, so we know when to stop. The text length behavior would do the trick. Remember, the receive message value is going to be our text, so let's plug that in. Oh my gosh, here comes the fun part. We're going to use a timer. You can set how fast or slow you want it to be. And you can also use a variable that can be dynamic so it can change each time. I'll keep it simple and just use a constant, like 0.1 seconds. In the timer, we will add the current character variable by 1. So yeah, just use the add values behavior, add it by 1, you know. And in that box container, we will use the result of the add values behavior so it updates for each iteration. After that, we will trim the text from the beginning to the current character. And this will give us the text that we will set the text object with. So here's a set label behavior. Let's test it. Woo! We're technically already done, but we can definitely improve it. Remember this timer that we used? After all of that text has been written out, that timer is still taken in the background. But you know, it should stop. So in the timer, after adding takes place, let's compare the current character and the text length. If the current character is greater than or equal to the text length, then it should stop the timer since the whole text has been written out at that point. To stop the timer, you would use the behavior off behavior. Yeah, this literally turns off behaviors. What'd you expect? Yay! Now that that's been done, we have to make sure to turn it back on when we want to use it next time. So, we used the behavior on before the timer behavior. And boom, we fixed it. Yeah. I also programmed it to show an arrow when the typewriter effect is done. See? You can do stuff like that. You can use any behaviors you want, please. Be creative. Now, the sound. This is an optional thing, but I know some of you will want sound with your dialogue. So here we go! In a typewriter effect, you have probably noticed that there are some pauses in between words. Listen closely. It sounds like Morse code. Because it is. Just kidding, it's not Morse code. But we can easily mimic that effect. The typewriter writes one character at a time, and when it writes a space, there's no difference, so we don't play a sound when there's a space. We only play a sound when we come across a character that is not a space, so anything other than a space. To get the current character that the typewriter is currently on, we can use another trim behavior after the trim behavior. Yeah, two trim behaviors, yeah. It will use the result of that behavior and trim from negative 1 to the end. Negative numbers will read from the end. So really, we're just getting the very last character of this input. So we use this in an if behavior, and if this is not equal to a space, then yes, play a sound. I would use a sound effect that is short and a little clicky. I figured that those were the best types of sounds to use on a typewriter dialogue thingy. Yeah. And boom, we're done. That's literally it. Now, with the broadcast message behaviors, go crazy with it. I made a simple little dialogue using a sequence of broadcast message behaviors. You can even go further and have it change a bunch of things dynamically, like how fast a timer is or what sound to play. Yeah. That's all. Cue the outro. Wait. Before we end the video, I want to give a shout out to Clarissa's class. Woo! This is the first time I ever got to see them use HyperPad in a classroom, which is awesome. And all of her students are working on their own unique projects from scratch, which is awesome. I wish I could have done that when I was in computer science class. And yes, to the students who are watching this, I love you guys. Please keep trying. I know HyperPad can be a little difficult to handle. It's not like any other app that allows you to make games. HyperPad literally stands out. I'm pretty sure HyperPad is one of the most powerful and innovative software that you will ever use in your life. And that's coming from me, who is a HyperPad user. And yes, I am the ambassador, but I'm also a HyperPad user. I'm no different than any other user who's trying to use HyperPad. So to all the students who are watching this, to every single person who's watching this, keep striving for the best. Remember what your goals are. Sure, making mistakes suck, but the trend of having less mistakes over time proves that you're learning because you're not making the same mistakes over and over again. All right, that's my motivational speech. Wow, I added like 2 minutes of watch time to this. And yes, thank you for listening. And Clarissa, I hope you the best because you're gonna be an awesome teacher. I know.